Hi everybody, this is Mark reporting from the Sabi Sand Game Reserve at world-renowned Juma Game Reserve, where reports have it that a live safari that has been going on for 4 years now will be shutting down later this week, much to the dismay and disappointment of many people all over the world, including the Nyala that are walking around here and including the crew of three that have been working diligently to try and bring you the safari drive for the last few months. My name is Mark. Seb's on camera, Tara's in final control, and we are standing, we're parked right here in the car park of Vuyatela, surrounded by Nyala. Nyala that seem to find sanctity in the grounds of the lodge. I've been wandering around collecting seed. Here are the impala lilies. Now, I don't know if you remember, but in the dry season, we had these impala lilies in full bloom without leaves. And this is what they look like in summer. They've got leaves, but no flowers. And I've been pocketing a few seeds from them. I'm hoping to germinate them. I do have some seed at home, or rather some impala lilies at home that I grew from seed about 16 years ago. They're doing quite well. They are about size of, they're about a foot high and maybe about an inch in diameter, which goes to show that those must be decades old. Well, at the request of a few viewers, we're coming into camp to have a look at a wall of remembrance. Oh, mind the logs, Mark. So there we go, closest I can get to it. Joe, I hope you're watching, and I'm not too sure who else is connected to this wall, but we have a number of names carved in wood, and the latest one, of course, Carm, is Joe's wife. There's Judy in Wisconsin, Mary from China, Bob's, Chucky, George, Bindi in Australia, Jim, and Judy in Virginia. Viewers that have been with us over the years who have passed away, and this is in remembrance of those viewers that were part of the community. I don't know if anything is going to happen from here on. It will be up to Juma to continue that, and perhaps the viewers keeping in touch with the owners. Nice to see these Nyala very happy and peaceful in the lodge grounds. Not too many guests here at the moment, but they don't really mind about the guests. There was a big bull here too. Now, weather-wise, we've got a huge storm brewing in the northwest, the west and the northwest. There is a little bit of thunder rumbling above us. In fact, it could well be that this is all turning. Okay, we need to go because the vehicles are coming in. To collect the guests for drive. And we'll have to keep an eye on this weather because I don't know what it's going to do. Other than the bougainvillea, not much to show you that's flowering, except there's a little bit of blue plumbago that's in flower. I just want to say hello to Amos. Amos. Go on, enjoy. How are you? 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 I'll go and look for it now. Okay. But anyways, here's the blue plumbago. Not a very bright specimen at the moment. Oh, there's that Nyala bull. You get him? Let's have a quick look-see. Quite interesting in that These Nyala have become quite accustomed to people walking around, and they're not at all shy, so they do allow people to walk freely. I wouldn't say amongst them, I'd say they walk amongst the buildings. They keep their safety distance from people, but they are by no means that wary of them. So let's go for a drive, we'll see how far we can get. I don't know if this weather is going to close in on us. It's quite possible that it's all just going to move away. Nice to hear rumbling thunder. We have Karula and children to look for up near Impala Plains a little bit later. I think first let's go and snip around where Induna was. Well, let's first have a look what's on the open area. But I'd like to just take a really slow drive. I don't want to get too hung up on looking for anything in particular. I know that we've only got a few days left and it would be nice to see some of our special characters. But I don't want to go and ignore everything else just to find them. We will go and look for them and to the places that they've been. But on the way, I think we just need to keep track of other things that we see. I know we started off with a lot of hype about this the beginning of the month. And we all diligently tried to tick off as much as we could. Well, I think what we did was we tried to space it out for the 20 drives that we were, or 20 days of drive that we were going to be doing. Hello, wasp. Where'd you go? On the ground, you damaged your wing now. Did you fly into the car? That's sad if it did. It's a very special wasp. It's got an internal parasite coming out of its abdomen. That's probably why it didn't fly too well. Believe it or not, that wasp kills tarantulas. No, it doesn't kill them. It stings them. Buries them with an egg. And I'm hoping that nothing. That I didn't do anything to damage it. Well, I didn't. The car might have. But I would have thought that... I don't know, it was kind of flying very low and funny when I first saw it, so maybe something stood on it. Thing is that you do get these internal parasites in insects that when they start emerging, it does damage their behavior, or it does change their behavior. Where did she go?
Somewhere in the grass there.
They do have a sting. They have quite a powerful sting. They have to be able to subdue the spider 10 times their size. I just want to show you that sometimes when you handle things gently, they don't necessarily use their defense mechanism. I've handled wasps pretty much all my life. I think I've been stung once or twice. Only once ever through handling it, a couple of times by mistake, sitting on a wasp or leaning against it or getting too close to its nest without knowing it. And the one time I saved the wasp from the pool, probably its natural reaction was to sting the first thing it came in contact with. It happened to be my hand. Hello, Impala. Gosh, look at you, you're about to drop your baby. That's called a spider hunting, one of the spider wasps. And very impressive to see her fighting with a baboon spider. Baboon spider, essentially the African equivalent of a tarantula. Spider's as big as my hand. The wasp invariably wins. It's just best to get one sting in. Immobilizes the spider, stings it a few more times, and then she'll drag it off to her burrow where she'll lay an egg on it and cover it up, and then her larva will hatch and have a fresh spider to eat. See, if she stings it and she kills it, the spider will dry out before the wasp egg will hatch, and then the larva of the wasp has nothing to eat. So it's quite important that when a wasp stings its prey, it only puts it into a coma. There's this group of male waterbuck we saw this morning. Don't really get a nice view through the trees of them. Bachelor group. One big bull and a few younger bulls. Little boys that were sparring earlier today. Ah, Gari gang. Now this is something interesting that we saw just after drive, just after I said goodbye to you this morning. The most aggressive I've ever seen the likes of some of these children. Hanging on a tree for dear life. One in the grass, another in the tree. Don't know who's who right now. Who can we look at? Anyways, there we were. We had signed off and we were coming back to camp past the lodge. And Gordy and one of the women with the baby, I couldn't tell who it was. Could have been Shirley. They were chasing a vervet monkey with a new baby, and they were intent on killing her. It was quite strange because they were aggressive, about as aggressive as I've ever seen baboons get. There's one of the ones that looks like little Genesis.
Put that tree in the way, Mark.
Which one? No, I mean in that tree there with the baby. That looks like Genesis with its mom. A little bit too small to be Evelyn. Well, I hope they didn't catch her. They came running across from the lodge, all over the roof of Yuri's house, down the other side onto the open area near the lodge where the camera is, shouting and screaming. What are you going to do? You go to the end of the branch and then jump from there. It's going to break before you can. Oh, that's Genesis. Pulling off bark. Wonder what she would be eating underneath the bark. Could be resin. Could be she's getting to the inner bark for medicinal use, and only she knows what it's for. My guess is they're hanging around close to their sleeping trees because there might be storms coming in later. It's looking quite heavy to the southeast. The thunder and noise that was threatening our drive this afternoon has already moved north. It's way out of our way now. Some more storm activity in the west. Eating grass, plucking a couple of blades at a time. They somehow derive nutrients from grass, baboons. I mean, it only constitutes a very small percentage of their diet, but okay. That was Gordy, actually. Genesis is with its mom, who was down on the ground to begin with. Who's Genesis' mother? Tara. Who's Genesis' mother? Surely it's Shirley. Don't you love that old movie? What was it? Airplane or something. Stop calling me Shirley. Roger. I remember most of it. Anyway, silly stuff. I just remembered something. And having picked up my binoculars, I disturbed what it is. That I brought to show you. There it is. Okay, I'll try not to remember to break it. Somebody asked me about hawk moths the other day. If you're on drive, let me know, because I brought you a hawk moth. Our sand lizard, sand felt lizard, the scrub lizard. We would not be able to get that on camera without having a camera on the ground. Gee, that is very dark. That might get to us later if it comes a little bit to the west. But a big storm front that's hanging over the southeastern part of the Sabi Sand and Kruger. Good chance it'll move up along the eastern skyline. just have to keep an eye on it. I know there's a lot of questions that we didn't get to this morning. Sometimes we get so many questions we can't get to them all. And if you have asked questions in the past and they haven't been answered, please feel free to send them through.
Hello, buffalo.
Was that a female buffalo? Also, anybody got any idea of who was at the Juma Waterhole Cam today?
No, it's a big bull.
The bulls that were at the dam, maybe. Three or four of them. They just looked like they had very thin horns. They were very big horns. Had anything special come down to the water today? Close to going out on drive, but I'm going to take a chance and go across the dam wall. I think there are only two guests in camp. And I'm sure they must be getting ready for drive. They're only leaving in 10 minutes. Go away, fly. Need a fly swish again. Shopping, that's not the right shape for a bush. Oh, there's a tortoise in the road. Tortoise marching along slowly. Disappeared. Moving into long grass. This weather, I'm sure we might see another one or two. Interesting that the buffalo have all left the dam. See, lots of terrapins on the edge today. tree frogs are calling. Tree frogs think there's rain coming. Hello, Brent. Asking if generally the storms all come in from the same general area. How's New Orleans today? New Orleans. New Orleans, New Orleans. Bit of an algae bloom starting on the dam. Needs rain too. Oxygenate, flocculate. Weather comes in from the same area, Brent. I would say that storms, on the other hand, come in from different directions. Generally, yes. Generally, where this weather is hanging now in the southeast, that's where it comes from. So there's a good chance that this, we'll have to watch it, there's a big front hanging in the northeast. There's a good chance that that might make its way here. Although having said that, I've had storms coming in from the north, I've had storms coming in from the west, and sometimes when we get those kind of storms coming in from different angles to what is the norm, they normally are quite excessive storms. Lots of water, short amount of time, or lots of wind, lots of excessive. But yeah, generally that's where everything comes from, southeast. Our prevailing wind. Although we do get a northerly berg wind that comes in prior to the weather coming up from the south and the southeast. The Shangaan people say that when the wind comes from the north, it's traveling to the south to go and fetch the rain. And it normally does do that. When we have a northerly wind, within a day or two, there should be rain. Hello, Terry in BC, British Columbia. Do the water animals tend to get out of the water when the storms come in? Hippo and water buffalo. Wrong continent for water buffalo. They're in Asia. Our buffalo, although they spend a lot of time in the water, aren't called water buffalo. They are African buffalo. They have gotten out of the water. I would imagine that if there weren't storms brewing, they would possibly still be in the water, but somehow they're all moving off past Inga's house, heading down towards Philemon's Dip and Rebecca's Road. But hippos, no, I've seen hippos still in the water, in the rain, in the storm. I don't know what happens if lightning strikes the water. I mean, we were always told as kids when there's lightning you don't swim. I would imagine that it could travel through the water. Well, if it hits the ground close by, then it would have secondary effects in the water. Water being such a good conductor of electricity, but I have no clue as to how it affects life in the water. I mean, what happens to electrical storms out at sea? What happens to all the fish and the whales and everything? They don't get electrocuted. And salt water is an even better conductor, is it not? How fast the sky changes. When we left half an hour ago, there were huge storm clouds above us, rumbling thunder actually some quite loud crashes of thunder. Hello Vicky, got your 36th anniversary on the 28th. Want me to find you a flower? Okay. Fine. Mary Ellen, Rob, Ron, You'd have to put that mic on to answer them.
No, it's gonna sit down on the table.
Whoa. Sure. I see you. Go that side in a minute so that we're not looking into the sun. Oh, we have a leopard. Meow. Hello, brother leopard. He's hot. He's yawning. He's full. Full of impala.
He's huge, he's a big cat.
He is a big cat, and he's only 3 years old.
Mm.
He's going to be a monster. He's going to be bigger than his father when he's his father's age. I hope we're looking good, Tara. Now, during this little bit of time that we've been driving here, Seb was asking me a question because we have a couple of viewers in France, Veronique and Muriel, who asked a very interesting question. And Seb will have to answer them in text, in French. But bonjour, Véronique, and how would I pronounce Muriel?
Muriel.
Bonjour. Bienvenue. And the question was, how many plant types in Duma would have medicinal uses? And I wouldn't even be able to guess at a figure because I would fear I would be wrong. I wouldn't be able to say 20, 50 or 100, 200. But I would be able to say that almost every plant has some properties. Whether we've discovered them or not is another matter. But every single plant has got something in it that we or something could use as a result of either its alkaloids or its sap or its tannins. Something. Oh, she's such a beautiful cat. No, thanks, but that was... This could be for Bob's 90th. Bob's having a birthday on the 30th. Hello, Bob. 90th birthday, I have to congratulate you. I can only dream of reaching 90. At this stage of the game, I'm hoping to reach 50. I can't even think about 60. But for now, it's going to be a miracle for me to hit 50. So happy birthday for the 30th, Bob. I'm sorry we won't be here. Here's your birthday present. His name is Induna. He's a magic leopard. And we're going to sit with him a while. I am going to change position soon because we're looking into the sun. He's such a magnificent cat. In fact, let me move forward and be looking a little bit sideways. Hello, Giz. It's also an anniversary present for Giz. What 51st anniversary? Gosh. My parents have also been married 51 years. My mum and dad are 51 years this year. They'll be married 52 years next year. Happy anniversary for that date, Giz. Somehow I pegged you as a bit younger. Hello, Marilyn. California, eh? What was the wall I was saying earlier? Marilyn, that's a wall of remembrance set up by Pippa.
Pippa Moorman of Tuma. It started way back when the cameras first started, and some of the regular viewers who were with, I suppose, AfriCam in the beginnings of Wild Earth, regular viewers who sadly passed on, and those are the names of some of the people who were viewers and who have passed away. And the latest edition is Calm Rudolph. Sorry, Calm Miller. Calm Rudolph, Joe's wife. And Joe will be coming out to South Africa early next year, I believe. Spending time with Penny. Hello, Judy in Chicago. Quite an interesting, well, quite a common question we have, because we have so many viewers that are so concerned about the animals. And it's a natural question to ask. If there's a sick or injured animal, do we do something about it? Do we dart the animal, capture it, to take care of it? The answer is generally not, Judy. You can't really do that with wild animals. Now, there are a number of reasons. Oh, gee, I put my camera down, he yawns. I pick my camera up, he keeps his mouth closed. I mean, yawning shots are not that great, but it is nice to sort of keep track of their dental condition. Where are you going to go? I knew he was getting up. I could see it in his eyes before he got up. Don't go to Biffle's hook. Did he do it? Gosh, look how big he is. Maybe he doesn't like me talking all the time. Maybe I'm disturbing his peace. Andrew, you come in. Have you left the lodge yet? Come to Bivels or Cutline. Come to Bivels or Cutline for Ingwe if you want. Yeah, he's going to lie down in the shade of that bush willow. I think maybe he doesn't like my talking. That shade, no, he's not going to lie down there. Maybe he's going to Tumbuti Dam, maybe he's thirsty. Now, getting back to your question about animals being injured. Let's take one aspect of this. One aspect is on millions of hectares, or millions of acres, interesting little beetles feeding on the flowers of the sickle bush. And in these millions of acres, oh, there's a flower, he just stood on a flower, a beautiful white flower. We'll just have a quick look. That's Vicky's anniversary. Sorry, Induna, I'm just looking at a flower. We'll be with you shortly. Now, this is an interesting flower. Roger and his wife are celebrating 10th anniversary today. Happy anniversary to you too. Up to anniversary and birthday wishes. Cycnium adenensi, and the name Cycnium actually comes from the name Cygnus, which is the swan. And if you look at the corolla tube, the long white corolla tube of that flower, it's supposed to resemble the neck of a swan. I don't know. Oh, he's going to scratch on a tree. it's such a beautiful shot, and we're just not in the right place because I stopped for a flower. Oh, I missed the shot. Oh well, can't win them all. And up ahead is that impala who, I think it's that one, who led me to him this morning. Yep. Female impala there. Was shouting at him. So, getting back to injured animals. To give you an example, there are approximately 15,000 elephants. There are 20-something thousand buffalo, maybe more. There are thousands of giraffe, thousands of zebra, probably 100, 200,000 impala. It is physically impossible to monitor every animal. It is physically impossible to know when an animal is injured or not. And when we do find an animal injured, if it's a natural injury, nature has to take its course for many different reasons. And most importantly of all is that it is nature's way of ironing out the weak and the injured and making sure that the gene pool of any particular species is still a viable gene pool. And if an animal is sick, and it's sick as a result of a virus or an illness, look at that, I'm missing the most. He was framed, but he's seen something. He was framed under that log and I missed it. He's seen that impala now. Oh, but Henry's coming in from there maybe. That impala's gonna move. Hello, Induna. I can't believe how big he is. Suppose I'm in the way now. And he's fat and healthy. Now there's another aspect to helping an animal that is sick or injured, especially being a wild animal. And that's perhaps one of the most important reasons why one has to leave them alone. And that is because the process of having to drug them and treat them and put them through the rigors of being in touch, being in contact with humans will kill them quicker than the actual injury that they have. Okay, well, why don't you just lie down right in front of my tire? Now, to dart an animal, the drugs that are used are a nervous system suppressant. In other words, they relax the muscles of an animal. The animal is still fully awake, it is still fully aware of what is going on around it. However, it's incapable of moving or feeling anything. So it's still hearing stuff. You often find that when animals are drugged, their eyes are covered so that they can't see what's going on. But all their senses are working. So here you have an animal that has never been in touch with humans. It's developed this fear of humans its entire life. And all of a sudden, it's got humans handling it, doing all sorts of things to it, probing and probing and injecting and... you know what he was sniffing? There's snake eggs here. He was sniffing this hole. Something has dug up. It's probably a honey badger, or it could even be a monitor lizard. Can you see this hole? You can see all the egg cases of a snake, and it's probably a fairly large snake. something has dug up the egg cases of the snake and has eaten them. You can see all the discarded eggshells. Now, snake eggs, reptile, especially snakes, they're more leathery than anything else, rather than the shell of a bird's egg. And that's what he was smelling. When he was right in front of the vehicle, we probably couldn't see him because he was so close to the front of the vehicle. Be interesting to see if there are any, there's still any live eggs down there. But that is the possible honey badger or monitor lizard digging that up. I'd say honey badger, the way some of those eggs have been thrust so far out of that egg, of that hole. Okay, I'll get your message, Induna. What age do leopards' noses turn black? Probably about the age of 5, going on 6, Madeline. I wondered why he had his nose in the hole. Oh yes, Madeline, of course. How are you doing, Madeline? Scotland, Madeline. Scottish shortbread and single malt whiskey, Madeline. Such a beautiful cat. I'm dying for him to move away so that I can go and poke my head in this hole where the snake eggs were. So I hope I finished sort of answering that question in terms of the amount of stress that an animal goes through if one was to have to dart it and try and heal it. But we've done it before. I've been involved in a number of exercises where we've helped hurt animals, and that's mostly, in fact only, animals that have been injured severely through the negligence or the, it's not negligence, the brutality of humans. Animals caught in snares where we've had to dart them and cut the snares off. And once even a leopard that had a broken leg, and it was thought that the broken leg was a result of a negligent guide. And so he was captured, and he was actually kept in captivity for some time until his leg healed, and believe it or not, he did survive. And any of the other animals that we have, that I have been involved in the process of cutting off snares or rehabilitating, have all gone on to lead very fulfilling lives. But it's not like you can dart a giraffe that's got a sore leg. Then you might as well put a bullet in its brain, because it's going to die from stress more than anything else. So it's hard. It's very hard having a passion for wildlife and nature, and being in this position where you've got to accept an animal's injury. You've got to accept seeing things that are breaking your heart. So yes, if you didn't get my answer earlier, black nose probably around between the ages of 5 and 6 when they become fully adult. Hello, Elizabeth, in Dubai. Oh, he was a bit cross-eyed there when he opened his eyes. He seems to know when I put my camera down. Maybe I'll just keep it up. Elizabeth wants to know if we will be returning to Juma after we leave, and how will we keep up with Karula and the cubs, and will dam cam be the only option. Now, I certainly can't speak for Tara and Seb, I can only speak for myself. I very much doubt whether I will return here, unless there's a job offering. Unfortunately, I will lose contact with Karula and youngsters and the story. I won't have much chance unless I get to a place where I have internet to log into the camera from time to time. But it becomes almost like an end of an era for me. I will have to... I don't know. I'm sure I will bump into Yuri and Pippo in town a lot. Always do whenever I'm there. It's a small town, can't help but bump into them. But yes, the only option right now is to have Karula and family come to the Juma waterhole cam where they might be seen, but other than that there's going to be no other way to follow them. See that mala up there? This is what my pimp on. She showed me him this morning. And she hasn't moved.
Yeah, of course, that day, the son was dead. She didn't go. There was a mampimpa running around.
Hey, what was that last question, Tara? Hello, Brenda. Annual rainfall for Juma. I would say roughly around 400 millimeters. Call it 15 inches. And could we go around the lodge buildings and, you know, somewhere along the line there is a Juma promo of all the lodge buildings. I have to be honest with you, Brenda, in the short time that we have left, especially because there are photographs on the Juma website, I have to be honest with you, I can't really see much point in it. I'd rather look for animals and get an idea of, or say goodbye to some of the animals. Also, it's not easy to get into the lodge with this vehicle. We used to be able to get in with the other vehicle. And it's easier to do, you know, when we did the original walkthrough of the lodge, we had a portable backpack that we could broadcast from, and that we used to use for live walks. And with the vehicle, all we're going to see is the back of a building. We're not going to see anything at all. Much like the other day when we were there with Seb trying to find Karula and the cubs, there was really not much you can see from the little road that goes into camp. But there is a fair amount to be seen on the website, and I need to find Peter Pretorius and Herman, I think. No, it was Peter, Rory and myself that did a walk around with the walking rig a couple of years ago. I'm sure that's on YouTube somewhere. Hi Patty, wondering if I can rearrange the Gunda to get a picture of me and Induna. I think it's probably going to be easier for me to rearrange myself within the Gunda to try and do that. Might be able to. It doesn't look very comfortable. Because he's full.
One, two.
Ryan, come in. Something coming off of Gowrie Main, near Little Gowrie Junction, going in a north-westerly direction. It's not quite a treehouse. Maybe buffalo. Ryan, do you copy? Any Western stations copy? Bad. Try and get them later. Biggest problem, I've got this huge box of books next to me where I could be sitting to try and get a picture for you, Paddy. I'm thinking that might not work. We're kind of close to him. If we're a little bit further away, it might work. Actually, what we can do is I can... Alright, let's do something. different, because with his head like that, I can comply somehow by doing this. Going to do anything in Duna, you should know me by now. So, can you get me in that shot? Was he too far away now?
No, it's fine, I get both of you.
Okay, well there we go. Me and Induna. Me and my friend Induna. Has anyone come back who was asking about hawk moths the other day? Or fireflies, who wasn't on drive this morning. Lightning bugs. No. Yeah. A different question. Hello, Deborah in Ohio. Markings on Induna that identify him. Him. Any marking. You can take any marking anywhere that would identify him. But then you would have to look at the same patch on another leopard and see the difference on another leopard. But I suppose what we can do... Tara, didn't you put up somewhere on a blog or something with rings and mark and notations and stuff? On his Facebook page or what? Tara's going to try and find you the link to a blog that Tara did. It's got little rings and triangles and things that give you an idea. But if you look at the spots around the eye, anywhere around the eye, and since we tend to often see a leopard's face, we tend to often look at markings. I mean, there's a marking on his forehead that's very distinctive, but since he's not... Hey Ryan, I've been trying to get you. Henry's got him, never mind. But he's got a marking on his forehead that's quite distinct. And if we look at his left eye now. Yeah, now he's looking at us. I'm just busy on the radio sec. Ryan, come in. Change channels already. Karula and Shivinzi on a baby impala on Simbambili side of Triple M. Oh, you can see his paw so nicely now. You can see the three lobes in the back of the pad. Some people say that that marking on his forehead looks like a turtle. Some people say it looks like an owl. I've always thought it looks like a swallow flying down his nose. It has changed over the years. It was a lot more compact when he was younger. Very interesting, Hillary. Do the prey animals ever connect the vehicles with the predators? I think sometimes they do. I've often seen impala behavior change a little bit, because it's almost as though they know that if there are multiple vehicles... Why are you doing that, Induna? I'm not doing anything. It's almost as if they know and if vehicles behave in a certain way that there could be a predator. Got a big tick in his right ear. What's he watching? Hello, Sarah. If he did take the impala lamb, is there no evidence? No, there's no evidence anywhere to say that he did. To the west of us, just over this ridge, is where he had an impala kill for the last few days. He finished that, actually, what, about 2 days ago, I think. So, I would say that the only evidence is possibly the fact that he's got quite a full tummy. And that it would be maybe a little, still a little bit too full for having finished that impala 2 days. I don't know. That's really hard to tell. Basically, there's no physical evidence. There's no sight of that needle in a haystack kind of thing. Wouldn't know where to start looking if he did kill it here somewhere and left a few pieces of bone. Are you getting thirsty? You want to go to the dam for a drink? I want to look at the snake nest. And I can't with you sitting there. Hello, Janina. Janina, there's no way really of knowing. I wish I could give you an answer. Janina's asking, do these cats know the three of us, our voice and our smell? And there's no way of knowing. I mean, I'd like to think so. It'd be nice to sort of go away thinking that they have known us. The fact that they've spent so much time around camp and that they have smelt us, they've touched our belongings, they've smelt our footprints, they've smelt our lives around camp. The problem is out in the vehicle, that the vehicles mask a lot of our scent. Who knows? I'm quite sure though, with a good sense of smell, they might be able to pick up individual scents. I think it's my feet scratching on the floor that make him look at me like that. But this is something only a leopard would know. There's absolutely no way of knowing that. I can tell you though, they do know this vehicle. That is a definite. The three of us tend to behave pretty much the same way when it... When it comes to being with the animals, this vehicle has a very distinctive look about it, a very distinctive smell, and of course the most important is the sound of this vehicle. And they are accustomed to that. The fact that there has only been three of us on this vehicle for quite some time now has something to do with the fact that maybe... what did you hear? Maybe they recognize us as different from everybody else. I don't know. It's not an easy question to answer. We can't. It's looking into the mind of an animal. Almost impossible task. Cloud that the sun's going behind, and shortly we're going to get really beautiful light. Okay, now that he's moving off, he's going to move closer to the snake nest. I couldn't tell you what snake eggs these were. Donna in Nebraska. Will Induna's tracks get bigger or will they stay the same size? They're gonna get a lot bigger. Go on, move along now. Thank you. Don't look back. He's aiming for that impala. You're sort of heading up towards that impala. She's seen him. I think I'll modify my assessment of who the thief is. This hole goes down very, very deep and it's very, very narrow, and it's only really a monitor lizard that could have gotten down there. But just quickly, here's some of the egg cases. Fairly large eggs. I couldn't even begin to guess whose they could be. Yeah, of course, now that they dry, they're quite brittle. Here's an interesting one showing claw marks. Those look like three claw marks, possibly from, and there are another three claw marks, possibly monitor lizard. You can see how these claws rake through this leathery case of this egg. Very interesting. This is quite pretty, actually. I think I'll keep that one. Now, not knowing what kind of snake that was, and with the hole being quite deep, I'm a little reluctant to start digging around in that hole for other eggs. there's a hyena up ahead. Maybe there's a kill in the trees. Maybe it's split in the trees. Come on. Yes, there it is. Aha. Hyena here told me that there's a kill. And he is looking at it. He's under the marula tree now. The baby impala is in this tree. He did kill it. So Sarah, there's your answer. There's the evidence. He's going back to his kill. The hyena's floppy ear coming. I'm going to stop here. So Seb, floppy ear's coming. She's going to chase him up the tree. And that's why Mom Impala hasn't left. Ah, as soon as floppy ear comes up, that's how he lost a bit of his tail. I'm sure it was floppy ear that took it off once upon a time. Henry, come in. I found that baby Marla. I found the baby Marla from that film, that Mafazi that's here. It's up in the Slashla, and one PC also. Nduna's now up in the Slashla. Wow. Yeah, just a little bit further west. Almost where you came in the first time. She's full of mud. She's been hanging out in Tambuti Dam, no doubt. You fat girl. Hello, girl. Glad to see you still up and running. Not the skull that I found. Ryan, come in. Quite incredible how she actually intimidated him like that. She doesn't do that to crews, she doesn't do that to other leopards, she only does it to Mission Induna. It's like she's got it in for them. Floppy. Clever boy you, huh? Getting a lot better at your kill protection. Very interesting. See, that's why we sit around with sleeping leopards sometimes. Because things change rapidly. So who, were you on her or him when he went up the tree?
Both. Well, I kind of... Kind of... Floppy ear first and then Duna going up the tree and then went back to Floppy ear.
It's a difficult one.
Yeah.
Unless you got it all in one straight line. Then wait for him to settle down in the tree. We can find a better position. If the sun pops out from that cloud in the west, it's going to give the most beautiful light. So I think let's try around there. Stop it, Eli. For now, she can probably go and lie down in the mud again. And wait for nightfall. Oh, dwarf mongoose disappeared down a hole. And are we going to be able to even see anything from this angle? What? Maryland and California, will leopards dig up and eat snake eggs? No, I don't think so. This is a very old hole that's been dug up weeks ago. There are a lot of spider webs at the entrance to the hole, showing me that nothing has been into that hole for quite some time now. And I very much doubt whether a leopard will dig up a snake egg. Snake nest. Maybe if they're youngsters hatching, young snakes hatching, maybe. That looking Is that any better?
One. Back again.
Okay, so we're back again.
Sad, this poor impala didn't really see much of life. I hope that in its short life it had a good little life. Hello Laurie in Georgia. A lion and leopard's pads the same, or is there some way to tell them apart? They are quite different, Laurie. The general shape is the same. The four toes and the shape of the pads, generally the same for most cats. All cats. I'm looking at smoke far to the east. I wonder if that storm sparked something. As green as things are. Must have. But no, Laurie, a leopard's prints are somewhat obviously smaller. Leopard are half the size of lion. So, apart from them being smaller, they're a lot more rounder than a lion's tracks that tend to be more oval in shape, more elongate. But I guess you could take a leopard of, say, Induna's size, and then a sub-adult lion, a lion of about a year old, and they could look very similar. Only thing is that lion of that age will invariably be with other lion and adult lion, generally speaking, so you will always see other lion tracks around it. Have you got that one horizontal branch in your way? I can go forward so that clearer view of his face.
It's not bad though, it's not in his way, and it's not in his not breaking his face, I mean. But if you want to move forward, it's fine.
And a bit better.
I was cooking last night, Laurie, and although I lost all my music on my computer, I figured actually what happens if I just plug my iPod in. My iPod, I can't play with headphones, but I can play it if I plug it into my computer. And I got it to play all my Georgia songs last night. While I was cooking, I made the most delicious lasagna, all for myself. Ate half of it and finished the rest for lunch today. That's a good question. Once the ticker's engorged itself, will it eventually fall off? I don't really know about that, Deb. I'm actually not sure. The problem is with those type of ticks, once they've engorged themselves, if it falls off, it can't move. Its body is so fat, its legs don't touch the ground. But then how do they lay eggs? Or maybe... don't know. You know, that's something I never really thought of. They do fall off a domestic and I don't know, Deb. Interesting question. I don't really know that much about the lifespan of ticks, or rather the life cycle and the lifespan. Deb, that's right. Deb was asking about hawk moths the other day.
Go ahead, Dan.
So was that Deb? Was that Deb, Tara? Bev? No, Bev, leopards don't purr like domestic cats. Only cheetah do. Ryan, come in. Any Western stations copy? Oh, I'll give up. Can't get hold of anybody. Deb, I brought a hawk moth to show you, one of the silver-lined hawk moths. And we'll do that after in Duna. Right now we've got the most incredible light. I don't really want to go anywhere right now, other than watch him on his kill. Uh-oh, he dropped a leg. Where's that hyena? Normally hyena that's lying close by will hear that fall. But Floppy Ear must have made off, gone off somewhere. Yeah, there was a reason why the female impala was hanging around. And you know, funny enough, I've seen this before in the past. When a female loses her new baby, I've seen it with giraffe even. And she hangs around because that sense of loss is so great. And maybe she's a new mother. And then the predator eventually gets the mother as well, because she won't leave the place where she lost her baby. It's sad. It is for us humans. It's hard to come to terms with. It's something that when one has a passion for nature, when one has this kind of drive to experience it in all its forms, is a certain amount of hardness to your heart that you have to have. You have to be able to close it off a little bit. Phil, come in.
Calling Phil.
Yeah, can you ask Ryan to get me on this channel, please?
Sorry, if you need to get you?
Ryan.
Okay, copy, will do.
Nice news about a big herd of elephant heading towards the Twin Dams. We might have to go do something about that. Oops, dropped the radio. How's it? Good, and you? Just an update on this Ingwe. He's got a bump of a baby marlin in the tree. Excellent. In here, plum coloured starling in the background. Stations, I'm going to be leaving the lock of this Ingwe on a bumba. Any stations interested? John, come in. Quite a luxury, I suppose, because it's a Monday. Quite a luxury. Having only one vehicle. But with us, like two vehicles. No crowding of sighting. Okay, what we're going to do, we're going to take a drive, get some air through our gills, and come back, maybe come back sometime later. But if there's a big herd of ellies coming, I want to go see them. Just trying to think what our best route plan would be. Almost, I suppose, back the way we came. Another juvenile sandfelt lizard. It's a bit more open, I don't know if we'll get it though. No, it's run away. Fine, Duna, see you in a few. About an hour maybe. Don't go anywhere. Don't finish your food too quickly.
Bye-bye. Take care.
I'm sorry, Terminale, I'm just borrowing a branch. I'll bring some wood glue later and put it back. Kimmy, didn't get the second part of it. But Kimmy just filling in for me, or filling me in, rather. Kimmy saying that when chicks engorge themselves, they then fall off, and a few days of lack of blood, they go back to a normal size and they're able to move around again. Thanks, Kimmy. secondary come in? I've left Terminalia branch in the road in case I want to go back to the Dingwe. He's on the Nyama at the moment. Kimmy wanted to know what age they... Oh, there's a fire. And that's where there was a lot of lightning and thunder. There's a lot of lightning and thunder there, so it could have sparked a fire. What age will they mate? Oh, it'll be a while, Kimmy. They've got to establish and maintain a territory first. So another 2 years, maybe. 2 to 3 years. Okay, we're going to have a black screen signal breakup. Let's get down to Central Road as soon as we can. With something in its beak, I wonder if it's going to a nest. You know that when a bird like starlings and all these birds have of note tonight. However, if we were elephants around Twin... Slalom. Does better mean we're okay? Guess not. Good. Yoela. And Yoela's 3 years old. Wants me to find an elephant. Okay. I shall make every effort to do so. Sky's aiming for a pretty fancy sunset this evening, but if I'm going to find an elephant, we might not see the sunset. I have to toss up between sunset or elephants. since the sun will shine tomorrow, I'd rather go for elephants. But sunset's still a little way away. Goella. 3 years old. I was saying I had a brown hooded kingfisher fly across my bow with an insect in its mouth. And you must know that when an insectivorous bird, like a kingfisher, or a hornbill, or a starling, or a shrike, any of the birds really, flying with an insect in their mouth means that they're going back to a nest. But ordinarily, if they were going to eat it, they would catch it and they would kill it and eat it where they catch it. So I wonder, should we do vulture's nest? I think Nyala Road South is a better bet. I prefer Nyala Road South. I like it better. Hello, lizard. Baby plated lizard at the hole in the termite mound. Funny how we're seeing so many of them. And you know, when you go off of this property, you don't see so many plated lizards, but you see more agamas. I went to Arethusa during the day one day, 2 weeks ago, I think it was. 2-3 weeks ago, sort of midday. It was something that I left in Ryan's car. I had to go and fetch it for drive that afternoon. And I saw so many blue-headed tree agamas, and here they're like diamonds, hardly see any. Yet I'm seeing more and more of these rough-scale plated lizards than I've ever seen in my past. So we need a few flowers too. I'm looking for pavetta particularly. For those who have an anniversary, pavetta would be quite appropriate, being bride's bush. Pentanisia would be nice because it has that sort of bluish, mauvish tinge to it that is a good birthday flower for Bob. 90 years old. My word. Ever found what? Ah, Deb. Asking about the hawk moth. I will show you shortly. But wanting to know if we ever found aardvark eating cucumbers. Not too sure where the emphasis is placed in that sentence. Sorry, squirrel. Are you talking about the cucumbers that aardvark eat, that aardvark eat, or the aardvark that eat cucumbers? But I have to be honest, Deb, I'm not too sure which species of cucumber it is. And the research that I did came out that that was mostly in the Kalahari. And I don't know if that goes for aardvark everywhere, and I don't know if that cucumber, particular cucumber species. Maybe, Deb, do me a favor. Just Google that again and give me the scientific name of that cucumber. Is it a cucumis? And what is its species name? I'll look it up in the book and then I'll tell you if I've seen it here. Whether we do have those cucumbers here. As far as I know, it's mostly only cucumbers in the Kalahari. There's a nice little rocky section down here in the drainage line, and I'm sure if we had to go there we would find things like rainbow rock skinks and maybe a tawny plated lizard or a giant plated lizard, different plated lizards to the plated lizards that we see. And anywhere where you find a rock, you're going to get a rainbow rock skink, which is also known as the five-lined rock skink. Beautiful skinks. The females and youngsters all have beautiful blue, bright blue tails. The males have completely different coloring. Wouldn't even think that they were the same species. Very strong sexual dimorphism. See, that sky's aiming for a beautiful sunset. Fingers in the sky, like a handprint. It's a gorilla hand. Yeah, that's a gorilla hand print in the sky. I smell elephant. Karen, interesting. Nice question there, actually. How far is the Timbavati from Juma? Is the landscape and general composition of animals and things the same or similar? Not too far. In a straight line, the southern Timbavati is probably only about 20 kilometers away. No, maybe a bit more. No, maybe 20 kilometers due north of here. Call it 12 miles. So the southern part of the Timbavati does look somewhat similar, yes. However, the northern part of the Timbavati, which is where I come from, is quite different. The rainfall is a lot less than it is here. There aren't as many species of grass as there are here. It's a more uniform ground cover and a different composition of trees. And a lot of the trees are the same. The knobthorns, the marulas, some of the combretums, the wattles and the guari, some of the other acacias, but it is dominated by Mapani felt or Mapani forest in places, and we get a much redder soil there in places. Here, as you can see, the soil is rather pale, not a very high iron content that's oxidizing that causes the reddish soils further north, and those soils do dictate a different grass base and a different, well, I suppose you could say different climax plant base, different climax grasses and different tree compositions. But a lot of it is the same. But because of the lower rainfall and the low diversity of grasses and things, we don't have maybe as dense a population of animals as the Sabi sand. It is ideal elephant country, and that I suppose I could say that there are probably more elephant up there than there are down here. I say there's more permanent elephant up there, whereas here we get seasonal gaps in our elephant viewing. The other thing is that what makes it perhaps a little different is that it's much deeper into the Greater Kruger National Park than this is. I mean, we are almost right on the western edge of the Greater Kruger National Park, and where I am, I'm 40 kilometers in, which is, 25 miles into the park. So the animals there have never really ever come across fences or anything. Interesting to note, by the way, that Karula and Shivinzi are on a baby impala kill, and so is Induna. And Ryan was telling me, I didn't know if he's got a kill, but Ryan was telling me that Mafufunyan is on Arethusa property. Didn't quite hear what he said that Mafufunyan was doing. Also evidently a big group of about 20 odd buffalo bulls coming across Gagari Main. Did I just stutter there? Gagari Main. Kami Fructus. Kami Cucumus. Karula and Shivinzi are eating their impala on Elephant Plains on the other side of Triple M. I'm not too sure whether they are visible from the road. can find out for you now that we're coming down closer to radio comms with the rest of the world. Please don't try this at home. The last time I was reading a book while driving, I nearly drove past a leopard. This time I might nearly drive past an elephant. Cressandra, no, cucumis. What does it start? Is it a C or a G? Ah, see, as soon as I open a book, there's an elephant. There you go. Somebody wanted elephants. Hello, everybody. It's me. No, I don't have that cucumis in this book. Okay, sorry, we're with elephants now. Oh, I know this old girl. I recognize her instantly because of the way she hangs her head so low. Oh, and she's got a little one trying to drink while she's walking. It's not like there are that many branches on that leadwood, Mrs. Elephant. You have to really take all of them off. It's almost like she's an old girl too. Oh, such a little one. Only a couple of months old. See, there's another old girl hanging her head very low. It's almost like her head too heavy for her body. Sadly, it looks like we missed them at Twin Dams. Some of them are quite wet with mud. And if I'm not mistaken, that little boy on our right with those two little tassels, I know he was the one that was screaming the other night. If I'm thinking, possibly, could be the same little boy. There's something about him that's the same. I'm going to go forward. In fact, we'll go down into the Mulwati and follow them a little bit. Hello, little boy. There's a nice group of ellies here. Gotta be 20 maybe. Hello, children. You make me so happy. There's that little one. You make me so happy. Sorry, madam. Wait till you've finished feeding there and then I'll move on. Just quickly, before it gets dark. Silver-lined hawk moth, dyed and dried. It's got beautiful silver stripes on its wings and silver patches on its abdomen. And what I've tried to do is I've tried to expose its hind wing to show you this very distinct red patch that it will show in displays as a defense mechanism. Hello, little one. Actually, I suppose you could have even been the one that was shouting the other night, but this could be a completely different herd.
There's that little one.
Did you get this?
Yeah.
Joanne from Arizona, how old is that female? I haven't the faintest idea. No way of telling until I can see her teeth. There's another family unit on the other side of the drainage line crossing Mamba Road as well, so there's a good number of elephants here. She could be 40, she could be older. See, he could even be the one that was shouting two little straight tusks. Hard to tell these things unless we got a really good idea of a particular marking or something. See, now another big family group. So this is a big herd. This is a fair sized group of ellies all moving north up along the drainage line, capitalizing on a lot of this vegetation that is now getting very green. The trees that tend to grow in these riparian areas are somewhat different to the trees that grow out in the sandier soils. These are trees that tend to grow in the denser clay, more clay soils. Somebody's shouting. Get to this little one here with this old lady. Unfortunately, I can't tell how old she is. It's quite hard once an elephant reaches maturity. It's quite hard to guess their age. Actually sitting on that log. Oh, she's getting a little bit testy with that youngster. He's putting his nose where it doesn't belong. Mainly what he did was he approached a tree that she wants to feed on before her, and there are courtesies and manners required in elephant society, and discipline is a very important facet of their lives. When it comes to feeding and water, an old lady like that won't tolerate a youngster getting somewhere before her. What is interesting is that she's quite an old girl, yet she's got such a new baby. And I must take a photograph of her. I need to actually have a look, because if I'm not mistaken, the last time I saw her, she didn't have a baby. Her baby's only a couple of months old. Mkulushambi and Dlov in the Mulwati, just north of Mamba Junction. Some serious itch on my leg, I don't know if it's a mosquito bite or something. Okay, let's move up a little. I'd like to just watch her and the baby for a while. Little one's already playing with vegetation. Big sister to help it. Lots of orioles shouting. This is not a thorn, by the way. From the sickle bush. This is a spine. That's a modified branch. This is a thorn. This is a modified leaf, not a spine. Hello, Phyllis. Shalom. Sorry, old girl. I just wanted to get a photo of you, and it's too late now. Phyllis wanted to know if elephants are fertile all life long, or do they go through menopause? As far as I know, elephants, as with humans, and I think whales, are one of the few animals that actually produce young to quite an old age and then are still actively involved in upbringing after menopause, because the learning process of the young takes so long and it's important that they still play a role in the upbringing and the training of youngsters. To answer your question, I think the answer would be that they do stop being reproductive at a certain age, yet they, unlike other animals, that once they reach that what we call senile point in their lives where they're no longer reproductive, and they don't live very long thereafter, but elephants do, and that is because they play such a role in the upbringing of children. Okay, time to move on a little bit. One's playing with some sedge grass. Can you see it yet?
Is it small?
Trying. Those tall, just to the right, the, where that little one's backside is, tall sedges known as cyperus, C-Y-P-E-R-U-S, cyperus distans. And it's actually a very important plant in local culture because mats are woven from the stems of those grasses once they've been dried, and very intricate weaving too, using colorful thread, colorful strands of wool to make beautiful patterns, and they become sleeping mats. And there are still people who sleep on those mats. Patrick, I remember, for those of you who've been with us for a while, we used to have a guide named Patrick from village outside the reserve. Patrick grew up on a sleeping mat made out of the cypress or the sedge grass. I've got a number of them at home. In fact, got a friend back home who actually makes them. Only problem is that nowadays she's gone a little bit modern and psychedelic, and it's no longer the beautiful ones of old. She wraps the stem in shiny chip packets, chips and crisps and knickknacks and things. So they become very colourful, very interesting, and obviously maybe provide a little bit more insulation against the cold floor. But they aren't as nice as the old ones. of long ago. Time to move up again. Okay, try and spell that lodge for me. Parrot Lodge. Ntabiso. Sawubona. Kunjani. I'm hoping you can understand me. Parrot Lodge in Zimbabwe, it's wonderful that you're watching us. How many liters of water can an elephant drink in a day? I have to be honest, I've never measured it. I find it hard to measure something like that. As far as I know, they say that it's... I think in the books you will read that an elephant will drink 150 liters a day. I have a problem with numbers like that, because... what size elephant was it? Does that mean this little one here is going to drink 150? I suppose it's an average for an adult elephant, but I like to just think that they do drink a lot of water a day. They do drink a lot of water. It is 100 and something. It is a lot of water. I think it would be hard to measure it in the wild. I think it's easy to measure it in a zoo, because in a zoo you can give them 50 liter buckets and count how many buckets you give them and how much they finish. But it's like people saying that you'll get guides that will recite numbers. Elephant eat, or maybe it's 200 liters, 150 kilograms a day, and they drink 200 liters a day, and they have a gestation period of 22 months, and guides will just rattle off numbers, but it doesn't help people understand elephants, because they're just numbers, and... elephants will eat different amounts of vegetation depending on what vegetation is available to them. And because they eat such a variety of vegetation, from leaves to bark to roots to branches to grasses, I mean, if an elephant is eating mostly grasses one day and mostly bark and roughage the next day, it's going to be a completely different weight in the food that they're consuming. And that's why I don't really like numbers. To me, it'll suffice to say they eat a lot and they drink a lot. I have to be honest, I don't see any need to put a figure to it. I mean, it's just my personal opinion. And I know that a lot of people like to have figures. People like to have very specific numbers. And the books show numbers, but it's an example. It's not to say that every elephant does that every single day. Not like an elephant goes to water and drinks around 200 liters every single day. One day it might drink 100 and another day it might drink 300. Come, little boy, are you going to stay behind that bush, because I want to catch up with your mother. What I can do is we can go, let's do that actually. I'm going to go back up onto the road and we'll go around to Spaghetti Junction and come back into the riverbed and watch them approaching us from the other side, rather than seeing the backside of the elephants. Ntabiso, very nice to hear from you in Zimbabwe. Parrot Lodge, I'm going to look, hope you've got a website. I'm going to look it up when I get back. Which reserve are you in? Can't stay with these elephants for too much longer, because it's starting to get dark and I don't want to be with the ellies in the dark, especially with a little one. We're not going to be able to see anything, because I'm definitely not going to put lights on them. And as it starts getting dark, I'd like to make our way back to Induna male leopard and see what he's doing on his kill in the tree, because I've no doubt that hyena would have come and found that leg that dropped, and Floppy the hyena might be at the base of the tree waiting for another scrap to fall. Bend Lorb now approaching Spaghetti Crossing. Spaghetti Crossing, Spaghetti Junction. The place where there's spaghetti. And my beautiful sunset didn't materialize. Or maybe it did while we were with the elephants. Down in the riverbed. A little bit of orange cloud in the sky. The storm that was threatening in the southeast has receded considerably further to the southeast. Maybe gathering strength to make a second onslaught later this evening when it's not so hot and the heat doesn't keep it away. Cooler temperatures allow things to build up better. Sharon in Tampa down in Florida. Florida. Gosh, these ellies are moving fast. They're already here. Are baby elephants born with teeth or do they emerge later on? And the answer there is they're born with their baby teeth. But they lose them fairly quickly when the adult teeth start coming in after the first year. It's only really the tusks that are baby teeth. That first set of molars is already there when they're born, and it's the second set that starts coming out already at the age of 2-3. Now this is the front of the herd. We were with that female and that youngster towards the back of the herd because they must still be down the riverbed some distance. And these guys are all moving into thicker vegetation. Let's drive down the riverbed a little bit and see if we can see her and her children coming along. What's so remarkable is that this whole herd has totally disregarded our presence. They're so busy feeding. This wonderful smell of elephant. I can go to bed tonight, but the smell of elephant in my nostrils, I don't know if any of you realize what that means to me. And I know, I live with them most of my life. When I go away from here on Friday, I'm hoping that I will go home and I don't see very small footprints there. Maybe this female's already moved on. I mean, we were just over there, so she might have already moved that way because there were some very small footprints behind me. Unless there is another youngster here. I have no doubt that shortly after getting home I will have elephants around me, but it's been a while since I've gone to bed at night with the smell of elephants in my nostrils. And not only the smell of them, but the reverberations of their sound in my chest, and the memories of their... There's hyena, hello hyena. Lucky the ellies didn't find you. Now I think, yeah, that must have been the baby's prints that I saw now. And I think, I would say that this is one of Floppy Ear's children. Because it's one of the oldest of all the cubs. Doesn't spend much time. Actually, that's what we were going to do, wasn't it, Seb? We were going for you to say goodbye to Teddy. Mm. Are you leaving early tomorrow?
No, I'll be on driver's tower tomorrow morning again, so...
Oh, okay, so you're going to chance tomorrow. Oh, are you going on driver tower?
Yeah.
Okay. So who was our three-year-old that wanted elephants? Spelled it. Oh, Joel. Glad you saw your Ellie's. Because you got Ellie in your name. Joel. E-Y-O-E-L-L-E. Joelie. Yo, elephant. Yo, elephant. Yoel. Yoela. One day you'll come to Africa when you're a little bit older and you'll see an elephant. I think we're going to have to say goodbye to our elephants. Our yo elephants. Yoel's elephants. Because it's starting to get a little dark and we're going to go and find our leopard. Before we go to bed. Bye children. Thank you. Can't see any of them. You know, if we had to drive through here right now, we would never know that there were 20 or 30 elephants here only minutes ago. Cannot see a single soul. They've all dissolved into the bush. Quite amazing how such large animals can disappear. Hello, Helen. No joy, is he? Now there's a nice question. I can talk about that for hours. Helen from New Jersey. What animals have the greatest maternal instinct? Well, I think mothers of any species would argue that they do. But what I can tell you, oh there they're still here on Vulture's Nest. Idle or sidle, we'll sidle past them. We'll slip past them quietly. Obviously, elephants have a very great maternal instinct. But I have to tell you that some of the smallest creatures have got exceptionally strong maternal instinct. Bye-bye, children. Bye-bye, Ellie's. Here's a little boy. They're moving up towards Yala Road South. No doubt they're going to get to the likes of Buffalzook Dam sometime this evening for a drink under starlight. Do you know that scorpions have one of the strongest maternal instincts? Oh, here's a flower. Finally, the flower for anniversaries, birthdays. flower of the day. I love this flower. This is one of the gladioli. I'm not too sure which gladiolus. And if it's only starting now, in the next few days, we're going to see some of them where the whole head is going to be. Let's just give it a bit of light. Oh, is that okay or is it too much?
Nice.
A little bit drier. Give us a bit more rain. The flower will be a little bit bigger and the others will be open. Actually, I can see a whole little patch of them underneath that bush willow to the left, but it's underneath. You might be able to do focus pull with the thorns. If I those in there. Have you got any gap to those in there? Glads make me glad to be alive. Sorry. I can multitask with some things, but looking at a book and looking where I can, my eyes can't multitask. The beautiful sound of the rainbird. Not that one. Not that one. Gary Main down at the bottom, two leopards. I'm actually not sure which species they are, to be honest. There's so many glads in the... Anyways, I'll try and find them. I know last year I had a problem finding them as well. It's so funny hearing some of these people talking and using local words in the wrong tense or context. Come lights on, thank you. Now I was saying elephant something before I was rudely interrupted by my own by myself. I think it's a sign of insanity when you interrupt yourself. Yes, maternal instinct. Scorpions, spiders, wasps. Some of the smallest creatures that have a very strong maternal instinct. In terms of providing shelter and food for their offspring. But scorpions more so, and some of the spiders like wolf spiders and nursery web spiders, more so in that they actually provide protection and food for the young. All mammals, I think it is a characteristic, it is one of the things that make mammals mammals. That very fact that a mammal has mammary glands, produces milk and suckles her young is an indication of a strong maternal instinct. And that bond that must develop, I don't think a man will ever know what that bond could feel like between a mother and a child through the act of suckling. That's even after the carrying the child. Excuse me, Franklin, but you want to sort of move off the road perhaps, please? Go that way. Thank you.
So glad you listened.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
Obviously, some of the mammals, the maternal bond is stronger in some and weaker in others. In terms of how far a mother will go to look after, protect, and care for its young. And we have a look at giraffe. Oh, what's that? Something ran through here. Oh, Carl and her baby. Three. That's unusual. Two adult females, three babies. I'm not shining my light though. Two female impala, three babies. Okay. That kind of leads to one thinking that maybe there are twins. Giraffe are not really known for their maternal care. They have the maternal instinct. But when it comes to the actual maternal, no, there are three adult females, I'm sorry. There were only two that were running with the little ones. The other female must have been running off to the side. But it's getting dark, I'm not going to shine the light on them, especially those little ones. But, you know, there again, giraffe are not known for their strong maternal care because they tend to... It tends to be more visible when giraffe leave their youngster and go off and browse and then come back to suckle. And yet animals like antelope and a lot of other animals do that, but especially things like duyke and steenbok, who will leave their young and go off. One doesn't really see it as much, so you can't really gauge whether a giraffe is more or less maternal about things. Birds. There are even fish that show strong maternal bonds. I mean, all of the mouth breeders, for example, the cichlids, we have some in the big tank at Wiatela, and I'm fascinated every time I'm there for dinner watching these tilapia when they do have youngsters and how the little ones fight to get into their mother's mouth when they feel threatened, or how the mother will open her mouth and get all of her babies in her mouth. I mean, that is a fair amount of maternal care and maternal instinct there in itself. In some snakes, there's maternal care. Pythons are known to watch over their young. Crocodiles show some of the most meticulous maternal care in any of the reptiles. In fact, perhaps more so than some of the mammals, in that crocodiles are very gentle with their young, particularly when they're hatching and they're moving them down to the nursery water, and how they will keep vigil over their young in the nursery water for a couple of months, 6 months even, until the youngsters can fend for themselves. So it is a very interesting subject. It's something that I've always thought about. It's something, especially with my passion for the very small things and the amount of time I spend watching wasps and spiders. Gosh, I could even tell you about, I wouldn't say maternal care, but certainly parental care over the larva, the eggs, and the pupa of ants, and how much they care for them and how meticulous they are about keeping the place, their nest and their burrow clean, to the point of having housekeepers in the form of silverfish, also known as fish moths, which are not really moths, but keeping, I suppose you could say, housekeepers on board. There are even beetles that live with ants and termites that also act as housekeepers to keep their nest free of bacteria and fungi that can affect the eggs and the larva and the pupa. So it is, for me, one of the most fascinating subjects to come across, because Now it just is. It's also got a lot to do with the survival of the species and how important that is for an adult to be protective over its young, no matter what species it is, and how some species have evolved to not show any parental care whatsoever. And most lizards, for example, lay their eggs and leave. Even some of the skinks, who are live bearers, they'll give birth to their young and they'll just fend for yourselves, children, each to his own. And how successful they are as a species despite not having any parental care. Andrew, come in. Where you now? Okay, copy, thanks. Okay, thanks. I'm a bit far. I'm going back to Induna. So it wasn't Gary Main. Sorry, what's that, Tara? Say black screen. No doubt gonna get a signal issue here. But if you can hear me, Shivinzi and Karula, even if you finished their kill and have come across back towards Jepala Road, that will be Tara's mission to. It wasn't Gary Main that they were crossing, Triple M. I wondered how they could get to Gary Main so quickly. There's that Mama Impala still looking for the baby. Are we back, Tara? That Mama Impala looking for a baby. Quite bad. A good chance Induna's gonna catch her later, maybe. like the fat lady's son. And he's gone off. Nothing in the tree. Doesn't look like there's any kill up there. Means he might be walking down to get some water. Back to Tumbuti Dam or... No sign of him here. Hello, Victoria. Victoria's in Pennsylvania. Hello, Victoria. 9 years old. Nearly getting to two figures, Victoria. Do elephants stay awake all night? Pretty much they do, yes. They might rest for short periods, but they pretty much stay awake. Oh well, there it goes to show, when you... A leopard in the hand is worth two in the bush. We've lost him. Not even a sign of Floppy here. So it could be he's heading down towards one of the dams. Down in this dip ahead of us, we have on the right hand side Tumbuti Dam, and then towards the left, further down south, is Gari Dam. So whoever's Zoomy this evening, keep an eye out. Nduna might come back. Although he was here and he was headed that way, so there's also a chance that he's headed east and he's gone towards Buffalzook Dam. Oh. Yeah. On second thoughts, he's going to Tumbuti Dam. Hello, Nduna. You're going back to the old tree where you were the last few days. Holly wants to know if any of the antelope can give birth to more than one baby at a time. Not usually, Holly. Nature has it that they mostly only give birth to one. Occasionally I think you might find twins, but very seldom. The problem with twins is that it's harder on the mother to feed two, and the chances of two surviving are less than the chances of one surviving. Even if one of them dies, two of them will be smaller than one. So it's not something nature does very often. Even though you might think that it would make more adults if they all gave birth to two. But unfortunately, it means that with only two little ones, or rather with two little ones, the mother's using twice as much milk, and she's got to, just it drains her more. It's just harder effort to raise two. I think he's going to go to Tumbuti Dam. He's sort of angling off to the right. Peggy wants to know if I ever saw a baby elephant being born. I haven't seen anything being born, Peggy. I've lived in the bush most of my life. Only thing I've seen being born is a cow, or rather a calf of a domestic cow. Yep, he's cutting through the bush now to go towards Tumbuti Dam. Doesn't like the sound of the Land Rover without the engine. Startled him. This is the problem that I can foresee. An initial problem is going to be a problem for a while. If electric vehicles were to come out, there are a lot of animals that would be taken aback by the lack of sound and the sound of the tires crunching. Okay, bye Nduna, we'll leave you be, boy. Moving off into Biffelzook, and in a straight line with where he's going is Tambuti Dam. We can't go there. So, Henry, come in.
Bye, Mark.
Yeah, if you're interested, I've just been following Nduna on Biffelzook cut line west towards Tambuti Dam. He's just cut through the Schlatin towards Tambuti Dam. That it's like there's lightning interference. Bye, boy.